Our next speaker is Dr. Anastasia Voronova. She got her PhD at the University of Ottawa. When she was a postdoc, she discovered a key step in the production of oligodendrocytes, building blocks of myelin. She's now a Canada Research Chair, Tier 2 in the neural stem biology at the University of Alberta. And one of her main interests now is being able to use neural stem cells to help rehabilitate the injured brain. Dr. Voronova.
Thank you very much, Jay, for this very kind introduction. Craig, if you could please fire up my presentation now. Excellent. So just so you guys know, there is a little square at the top right corner. So if you click on that, you can actually enlarge the slides. So I'm going to go ahead and start presenting this. So can you please go to the next slide? Excellent. So in my lab at the University of Alberta, we're studying how is the brain built and regenerated by neural stem cells. And more specifically, we're asking how the neural stem cells choose their fate. I kind of view neural stem cells as babies. When a baby is born, it can become anything it wants. All the possibilities are, and all the doors are pretty much open at this point. And so a neural stem cell will eventually be at the crossroads of trying to decide what it will become, because a neural stem cell will build our entire brain and spinal cord. But today we're mostly going to be talking about the brain. And so there are three main brain cell types that a neural stem cell will make. And so these are the neurons, which are your main signaling cell types, but also the non-neuronal, which are called glial cells, such as astrocytes and oligodendrocytes. And these non-neuronal glial cells are the cells that not only support the neurons, but also play direct roles in the physiology of the brain. And so, as it will become evident from my talk, we are particularly interested in trying to understand how the neural stem cells decide to become oligodendrocytes. So to speak, how do these neural stem cells graduate as oligodendrocytes, if you think about an analogy with children? So in the first part of my talk, we'll really be talking about how is the brain built. And then I will only use a couple of slides to highlight some of the data that is necessary to understand the second part of my talk, which will really center around the regeneration of the brain. Can we please go to the next slide? Excellent. So as you've probably gathered now, I have very specific interest in the oligodendrocytes and in neurons. So in the red, in the dark red, you can see an oligodendrocyte that reaches out to these pink and blue neurons and starts to form this myelin sheath. So it's kind of like a fatty substance that coats the projections of the neurons. And that is really essential for our health, for the brain health. And so from the neurons, another important concept that is going to be quite important for the rest of my talk is that there are these excitatory and inhibitory neurons. So what do I mean by that? Well, we have to excite, we have to transmit signal, right? So there are these excitatory neurons in our brain. But if we only have excitatory neurons, then we're going to end up with seizures and epilepsy. We have to dampen them down. And so this is where these inhibitory neurons come into place. And so they really dampen down the signal of the excitatory neurons. And so the oligodendrocytes will cover the projections of both excitatory and inhibitory neurons. Next slide, please. So why is that important? In this GIF, what I'm showing is that when the myelin is present, the neuronal transduction is really, really fast. You know, when you hit your toe on the door, you feel right away, your brain tells you that, don't do that again. This was very painful. And the reason why we can actually feel it so fast is in part due to this coating, the myelin sheath. And so we actually learn from human studies that learning increases the myelination. So for example, the brain MRI studies have shown that in pianists and jugglers, we have increased myelination. And our also rodent studies are showing that myelination is itself important for learning. Not surprisingly, defects in both oligodendrocytes and myelination are actually what goes wrong in many neurodegenerative diseases such as multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, Huntington's, etc., and also neurodevelopmental disorders such as autism and schizophrenia. Next slide, please. Excellent. So when I started my postdoctoral fellowship in the lab of Frieda Miller and David Kaplan at the SickKids Hospital, what I wanted to know was how do the neural stem cells make the oligodendrocytes during brain development in the first place? And so we used a mouse as a model system to study mammalian neural development. So in the top left schematic, you can see a section of the mouse's brain, and I have demarcated the cortex as the region that I was studying. So it's in the red box. So if we zoom onto this red box, then we would see that early in development, there's a lot of these neural stem cells. But then in the mouse, from embryonic day 12 to day 18, all the neurons are generated by neural stem cells. But at this point, this embryonic day 18, so it's very close to being born, somehow the neural stem cells magically know that they have to completely stop the production of neurons and start producing glial cells such as oligodendrocytes. And we really didn't understand how does the switch occur? What's the magic behind it? Next slide, please. Well, very often, one cell type that is forgotten in this schematic is the presence of these inhibitory neurons, just like I've introduced in the first few slides. And so they arrive in the cortex around embryonic day 14, but they really populate the brain, just like in the mouse, but also in a human, around the birth. And this is when these neural stem cells start to make these oligodendrocytes. So I thought, hey, maybe these represent a missing switch or a missing link in our understanding when neural stem cells decide that, okay, well, there are some cells that maybe give us clues or messengers, molecules that tell us now to become oligodendrocytes. Next slide, please. So I'm only going to show a couple of data slides here, and so bear with me as I go through this. So I decided to do very, very simple culture studies so we can isolate the cells from the mouse's brain and then we can grow them in a dish. So what I did is I grew the neural stem cells alone or together with these inhibitory interneurons, which have been tagged with green fluorescent protein. And so to my biggest surprise, there was actually a huge induction in the number of oligodendrocytes here in red, and no change in these other cell types that are called astrocytes. Next slide, please. So I'm not going to go through all the data, and I'll save ourselves some time, but I'll tell you that we found out that these inhibitory neurons were secreting something that was instructing the neural stem cells to make these oligodendrocytes. That was first key thing. And then the second thing was that in the mouse, we have a lot of tools to be able to ablate these cells. And so when we ablated these inhibitory neurons in vivo, we saw that there is a reduction in the formation of these oligodendrocytes. But what I was really excited about this, besides the understanding that this is an important component of a normal brain physiology and brain development, is that I could mine this to discover novel molecules that could instruct neural stem cells to make these oligodendrocytes. Next step, please. So what we did is we decided to do computational modeling approach. So I know that there's a lot of different factors here, but essentially what we decided to do is detect all the molecules that can be secreted from the interneurons, and then all the receptors, which are typically the molecules that respond to the secreted ligands in the neural stem cells. So by knowing which ligand or secreted molecule interacts with what receptor to change the biology of the neural stem cell, we then predicted that there could be 51 growth factors that could potentially regulate neural stem cell biology. Next one, please. So I'm not going to go through why I chose one specific factor, but I chose a factor that's called fractalkine. Next slide, please. If you are an immunologist, you will know what this is. It's actually an immunological factor, a chemokine factor. So it was discovered because it was attracting cells to migrate towards it. That's what's called a chemokine. Luckily for me, it was only functioning through a single receptor that is termed CX3CR1. And it's very highly expressed in immune cells in the brain, which are called microglia, but also at much lower levels in neurons and also neural stem cells. Interestingly, mutations in this receptor are implicated in a variety of central nervous system disorders such as multiple sclerosis, autism spectrum disorder, and schizophrenia. Next slide, please. So I'm just going to show a snapshot of something that I found, but it pretty much encapsulates sort of this novel finding. So we were able to use, for aficionados out there, it's called in utero electroporation approach. But pretty much what this means is that we can reduce the expression of the fractal kind receptor, specifically neural stem cells in the developing mouse, and then analyze the progeny, the formation of oligodendrocytes, when the mouse is already born. So here I'm using a mouse that was 2 weeks of age. That's pretty much kind of an adolescent stage, equivalent of an adolescent stage in a human. So in the graph on the right-hand side, you can see that when the expression or the production of this receptor was reduced, there was also a reduction in the production of the oligodendrocytes as well. And so essentially what I've done is I discovered this fractal kind, which is an immunological molecule. We had no idea that immune molecules could be acting directly on neural stem cells, that it's actually telling the neural stem cells to start producing these oligodendrocytes. Next slide, please. So essentially what I'm trying to tell is that I really think now of these inhibitory neurons as these crossing guards to tell the neural stem cells, so the kids, so to speak, to cross the road of trying to become these oligodendrocytes. And we think that this is a novel developmental mechanism. And these inhibitory neurons perform this action by secreting these factors with pro-oligodendrogenic properties. And these factors include fractal kind. Next slide, please. So in January of 2018, I opened my own lab at the University of Alberta. And what I was really excited and passionate about is how do we translate these fundamental developmental discoveries to brain regeneration and repair? And the reason why I'm so excited about this is, you know, I hope that you know by now, but maybe you don't, is that our adult brain actually contains neural stem cells. But unfortunately, they're kind of lazy. They don't want to do what they're supposed to do. They should be able to differentiate into oligodendrocytes when it's time to do so, but they just kind of lie dormant. And so if we can figure out how to wake them up or engage them and kind of hijack those molecular pathways that we discover in the developing brain, to then apply them to these adult neural stem cells through, for example, pharmacological intervention, then maybe we could figure out a way how to repair the brain as well. And the reason why I'm so interested in it is because in the normal brain, we have healthy myelin. Again, I told you that's important for our brain health. But for example, in the brain of a patient with multiple sclerosis, that myelin gets degraded, oligodendrocytes are damaged or dead. And so that leads to neuronal death, and that leads to neurological impairments. So if we could restore the number of oligodendrocytes, we could restore the myelin, and we hope that we can restore the neurological impairments as well. Next slide, please. And so that's exactly what we pursue in my lab. Can we use fractal kind or any of these other 50 factors that we've discovered to engage adult neural stem cells for brain regeneration? And so I'm going to give thanks right off the bat. This project is led by my grad student, Adrienne Watson, and she has formed a powerful team with my postdoc, Monique, another grad student, Nicole, and an uber-talented grad student, undergraduate student, Jessica Lee. So essentially, as I told you, we have these neural stem cells. Today, I'm only going to focus on one pool of these stem cells. And so in the adult brain, I've depicted these as blue blobs, and they actually come from the developing neural stem cells. Next slide, please. So in conclusion, I hope that I've convinced you today that it's important to study how the brain develops if we ever want to understand how to wake up or engage our adult neural stem cells to really help the brain regenerate. And so we are very excited that we found this novel molecule that's called fractal kind that is able to engage these neural stem cells to become oligodendrocytes. And we're now translating these discoveries to our multiple sclerosis mouse models as well. And although I'm not going to share the data, we have very encouraging preliminary results. Next slide, please. So I guess this underpins my whole research program. It's important to ask a question, why? What are the underpinnings of normal and abnormal brain development? So we can ask a question, how? How can we alleviate neurodegenerative disorders such as multiple sclerosis? Next slide, please. And that's it. I'd like to thank my funders, without whom none of this work would have happened. And I've already thanked all the people who are directly involved in this project. So I'm happy to take your questions at this point. Oh, Jay, I think you're muted.
It's my policy always to forget to unmute myself at least once in a presentation. So now I've done that. Thanks, Dr. Voronova. You were looking at something like 51 possible compounds. What tilted you to try a fractal kind first?
So I approached this from an ignorant perspective. And I guess that's the beauty of a non-immunologist attacking an immunological molecule, is I was ignorant of the fact that it was so important in immunology. And I just went after, hey, nothing is known about it in terms of its effect on neural stem cells. I'm just going to throw it on my neural stem cells and see what's going to happen. And I had this amazing result, and that gave me the confidence to pursue it. And now, actually, serendipitously, because it's also an immunological molecule, we actually think that we have found a way how to engage both immune cells and neural stem cells at the same time, enhance their communication for actually enhancing the brain regeneration, which is going to be so important in multiple sclerosis. I think it's going to be important to attack both the immune system as well as our regenerative capacity. So it's serendipity, but I think it's important to recognize that serendipity when it happens.
Yeah, indeed. Do you have any feelings that some of the other 50 might turn out to be important as well?
Yes. So Jessica Lee, who is the undergraduate student who I introduced, so she, when she came to me 3 years ago, she's, you know, said, I don't know what science is, let's do something. And so I gave her one of those other molecules, and it seems like we're getting some encouraging results. It's called hepatoma-derived growth factor, because it was discovered in hepatoma cells, and go figure what does that mean, but it has a direct effect, again, on our neural stem cells. So we're hopeful that we can actually mine that data set for years and years to come, because there's so much to discover.
So there's a question here from the audience. Did you test the effects on healthy as well as correlatable mental illness states, such as over-methylation with schizophrenia, mm-hmm. toxic overload with copper, autism, paranoid, schizophrenia, etc.?
I am very happy that, Siobhan, you asked that question. And essentially, we actually have a grant that is a European team grant, where that's exactly what we're tackling, is that we think that part of the schizophrenia mechanism is aberrant communication between these progenitor cells and these inhibitory neurons, which leads to sort of this defective myelination. And so we were hoping that we could exchange our students to go and learn all of these different techniques in different countries, but what we've done now instead, because of COVID, is we imported our schizophrenia mouse models from our collaborator in Paris, and we're going to be treating them again with fractalkine, and we're going to see whether we can rescue any of the behavioral deficits. So I think that this sort of line of work is not just necessarily targeted just in neurodegeneration. I absolutely believe that there is so much more to discover with mental illness or with neurodevelopmental disorders. And so I'm hopeful that in a few years, maybe I'll have a little bit more of new stories to share.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Voronova.
Thank you very much.